BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to another episode of New Arts Alive on BCTV, Berks Cable Television, Berks Community Television. And my name is Ron Schira. I'm going to be your host for tonight, taking James Carroll's place for just a little bit. And with me, I have a special guest. I have a painter. I have James Maria, who is an excellent realist, paints in watercolors.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Any other mediums that you work in?
Actually, in addition to working in watercolor, I do paint. I dabble in oil and a little bit in egg tempera as well. My journey mm-hmm. through art history has guided me a little bit in that direction, mm-hmm. a little bit of mixed media as well. So we'll see some of that tonight.
Oh, good, because we do have images, mm-hmm. but we'll get to those in a minute. I'd like you to tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Sure.
About your background, where you're from. You're obviously from this area.
Yep, absolutely.
And you have a working studio in the Goggle
At
Works.
The Goggle Works, correct.
Okay, tell us more.
Where does it begin? Well, I am a Berks County native myself. I grew up in this area in Shillington and then in Sinking Spring, where I went to Wilson High School and then decided to continue my education at Kutztown University, where I studied both art education and fine arts. 5 years graduating with degrees in both of those fields, and I employ both degrees today at the Goggle Works, where I maintain my studio practice, and also where I teach both private lessons and as a part of their program, their Ed's program.
So you teach at the Goggle Works?
I do, yeah, offering painting courses to adults.
Painting courses to adults.
Yep.
Very good.
Yeah. And my journey has taken me from Kutztown to here, but I've been blessed with opportunities to kind of explore the world a little bit. My painting has taken me here and there mm-hmm. as well, and we'll see some of that in my work.
Okay. So you also have a few shows that are going on in the area, is that correct?
Yeah, in the area and beyond. At this moment, we're just tearing down a show that we hosted at a gallery that I'm partially responsible for directing in Kutztown, at 314 West Main Street in Kutztown, mm-hmm. which is a space shared by a tattoo shop where I actually work. We've begun curating fine art shows, craft shows, and any opportunity that we can give mm-hmm. to enrich sort of the local community mm-hmm. with arts type opportunities. We're mm-hmm. working towards that. Mm-hmm. And just recently closed a show of my work, as well as the work of three other watercolorists, Jason Rawls, Laura Muehlhern, and Andrew Kish, all of whom are Pennsylvania watercolorists and, mm-hmm. and all of whom are pretty well recognized within both the watercolor community and the larger arts community for their accomplishments thus far.
And they're yeah. all very, very skilled.
Yeah.
As to what they do. Now, we've been noticing lately this swing towards realism,
mm-hmm.
okay? Now, for the last 100 years or so, the mainstay of art in the overall art scene, the overall art community, has been abstraction.
Sure.
Okay. So, and that's abstracted imagery and just plain non-representational work.
Mm-hmm.
But your work veers totally in the opposite direction from that.
Yep.
So, I mean, there's actual studies of light and perspective, mm-hmm. chiaroscuro, composition, you know, all of the technical, tools
sure.
that an artist would use to create a realistic work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I concern myself very much with the formal side of my, you know, kind of painting practice, and as do those other artists, you know, whom I mentioned. Mm-hmm. I think that that has no small part to do with the world of watercolor. It's an interesting microcosm in and of itself. And, you know, on one side of things, almost to a fault, you've got a very sort of academic endeavor. It's this mm-hmm. this pursuit of realism and of the formal side of things, whereas the big art world, centered in, you know, Chelsea and London and, you know, the larger cities, you've got the push towards the more conceptual. And I say, well, why can't it be both? Why do we need to devote all of our effort exclusively to either the formal and produce work that's just boring, you know, lacking in deeper content, or mm-hmm. or work that's so focused on content that we're not entirely sure what we're looking at from a formal perspective? So, you know, we've got opportunities to explore both of those things and pepper in, you know, some deeper thoughts while also giving the viewer something to just enjoy looking at as well.
Yeah. Well, do you feel that this is a larger trend that's happening, or is it something that you're kind of a beginner of, you know, kind of like an iconoclast for the area? Because I do notice that your work is remarkably different than even the realists that are around here. There's a change in content, a change in subject matter, and it's very complex.
Sure. So thank you. It is interesting. I don't know that I want to admit to being iconoclastic, but at the same time, I do feel as though it's my responsibility as a new watercolorist within that own sort of smaller community of the larger arts, you know, folk, mm-hmm. that I push the envelope a little bit. There's nothing mm-hmm. wrong with, you know, kind of expanding the borders of what's conventionally acceptable and what's sort of often exhibited within that realm.
Great. Okay. Well, we've made the viewers champ at the bit here to see some of your work. why don't we just go to the computer here and show a piece. Tell us about this one.
All right. Well, I guess the first thing that we'll address is subject matter. What we see here is an image of a defunct interior of what was once a high school in North Philadelphia. Once Thomas Edison High School, it went through a couple different iterations, a couple different titles, and served different roles in the community. Later, Julia de Burgos Magnet Middle School. This is the story of many of the buildings, the facades of Northeast Philly. Here you see the structure of the building is sort of falling apart. You see the order that humans once imposed on a space and on these materials as nature acts on it being sort of torn down by the elements as much as, you know, anyone who happens by.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what interests me. I mean, outside of the formal pursuits that I mentioned, the light, shadow, color, and how all of those elements of design and those mm-hmm. principles can harmonize with one another, the level of content that can be derived from the subject matter itself is something that's, you know, really important to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, it is very studiously worked on. I mean, your light and your shadow, your perspective, all of the you got all your ducks in a row there for sure. And it is a very complicated drawing as well as a complicated painting.
Yeah, absolutely. Drawing is in no small part a huge part of, I mean, it's a large part of my process. There's no denying that. I can't honestly say that I would be the painter that I am if it wasn't for my strong foundations in drawing and the tension and the precision, you know, that I demand of myself for that as well.
So you do make a really complex understructure before
Very well planned out, and that's in part necessitated by the nature of watercolor, and that is, as many of us know, it's not an especially forgiving medium. To have something poorly planned out could result in, you know, many hours wasted.
Yeah, the death of your painting.
Sure,
and
right.
Actually, that's, I mean, you have to, I mean, even with something that's not as complex as this, if you get the wrong color or the wrong composition on something, well, that's it. It's done. You got to start over.
It is.
Because it's not like you can scrape it away. It's not the same thing as an oil painting or an acrylic where you can paint over it. It doesn't have the, like you said, it's very unforgiving.
Right. We rely, as a watercolorist, I rely pretty exclusively on the white of the paper as the source of light that's in my work. The transparency of the medium is hugely important, and that's a large part of what I do.
So, you did tell us where you went to school, is that right?
To Kutztown, correct.
Kutztown
University. Yeah, where I studied with Matthew Daub, who also actually taught the other three painters with whom I had just shown. It was interesting, I just got an email from the Springfield Art Museum in Springfield, Missouri, and they are one of the, I would say one of the better collections of contemporary watercolor that is watercolor that isn't, you know, all florals and things like that. You know, really sort of forward, kind of art forward thinking work. And they contacted me because they have not only some of my work, but some of Jason's and some of Andrew's in their permanent collection. And they said, you know, there's something a little bit edgier about what you three are up to. Can you tell us, you know, what's going on here? And I said, you know, it's probably due in no small part to Matthew's influence as our, you know, former professor. So I have him to thank for that.
Well, Matthew's very precise in his procedures as well. And he did have, a few years ago, he had quite a large exhibit of his artworks over at the Reading Public Museum.
Yeah, featuring Reading itself.
Featuring Reading itself, right? I mean, one of the places that he painted was like right around the corner from me.
Yeah.
You know, that Milmont Hotel. That one painting of the Milmont Hotel is like not even a mile from me.
And he continues to paint some of, you know, Berks County as well. His most recent works have been Kempton and the creek up there that runs, the Maiden Creek. You know, his most recent works that were just shown in the Allentown Museum.
Allentown Art Museum. Yeah.
I have also, I mean, Reading has been surprisingly not as much of a source of inspiration as you might think if you're into painting, you know, falling apart buildings and things like that. I've found that the coal regions have also given me some resource material as well.
Oh, yeah. Well, across, you know, like you say, peppered across the United States.
Yeah.
We have a growing amount of architecture that is falling to the wayside.
Yep. Yeah, the infrastructure of America is crumbling, whether we know it or not, underneath our feet. It's really an interesting thing to observe and to document.
So this is there some type of a political end to your work?
Not so explicitly. I mean, it's really an open-ended question. I don't intend that I make any overtly political statements about, you know, declining or undulating, you know, fluctuating economies and things like that. Although it's a question that I ask my viewers to consider, you know, as is the case with this next image that we have here.
Yeah, let's go to the next one, please. Yeah.
This depicts the same location as the first one. This is actually a piece that it now resides in Kutztown's permanent collection. It shows the same school as the first image that we presented. So questions about the state of public education and the buildings that we erect for this purpose. You know, what does this say about public education in our metropolitan areas? We can go to the next image then, Ron. Here as well, this staircase.
From a different view.
Right. Yeah, a different staircase in the same building, but it's amazing how something that has been abandoned for a relatively short amount of time, less than 10 years, is in such disrepair.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's unbelievable, isn't it?
And you know, I focus not only on schools, but if we go to the next image, hospitals, hotels, other post-human spaces, and the spaces that a lot of people once occupied. I mean, it's not only the people that may have worked there or had gone to school that studied, you know, in those spaces or, you know, had been cared for in either these hospitals or the psychiatric hospitals that I've painted. I mean, it's all a lot to consider, and there's a lot of potential emotion to explore, not only in the works, but also as I'm exploring some of these places, I take all my own reference material. Mm-hmm. It's amazing, you know, all of the emotions that it can elicit as you're walking through these spaces, very emotionally charged kind of locations.
I also find these pretty amazing that they're watercolors, which is traditionally not what a watercolor would normally look like. You're so used to seeing something with this kind of detail done in a different medium.
Mm-hmm.
How do you go about? How does your technique go about documenting this? Do you actually go into these places and do elaborate studies and drawings, or do you work from photographs? Or
yeah, I will have to admit that I do in fact work from photographs, although I take all of my own photographs. I think that's very important for an artist. Not only because, from a, you know, a copyright standpoint, and mm-hmm, from mm-hmm. you know, an originality, making sure that there's an artistic integrity, you know, questions to be asked about working from a photo that someone else took.
Well, it looks like we have a home viewer.
All right.
Okay. Go ahead.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. How are you?
Ron.
I just had some questions for James. First of all, an observation, your work is absolutely terrific.
Thank you very much.
It's hard to believe it's watercolor. And your use of white space is absolutely, again, incredible, how you utilize the white space, which is very difficult to do and with forethought in watercolor. And boy, you have used it incredibly well.
I appreciate that. Yeah, it definitely requires the patience and the self-restraint to not just throw paint right on the paper. I mean, there is a degree of precision, but at the same time, I do appreciate the way that watercolor does its own thing sometimes, and to be able to partner with its own, how should I say, spontaneous nature and a bit of control as well is a cool experience.
Yeah, it can have its own mind once you put it onto the paper.
Indeed it can.
Which leads me to a question.
Mm-hmm.
Having done this years ago, watercolor and so on, do you still have to prepare your paper the same way you used to, wet it and stretch it out and dry it and before you can utilize it? Or have they improved the paper so that you don't have to do all that prep work?
Well, it depends on the brand of paper that you choose, and the weight of paper is something else that's important. And I guess this is as good a time as any to discuss the materials that I use. As, you know, some others may be kind of wondering. I use exclusively Arches 300-pound hot press paper, and the 300-pound paper weight is it's so thick it almost borders on the thickness of cardboard or cardstock. And because of that weight, it doesn't buckle in the same way that cheaper and thinner papers would. Mm-hmm. And that allows me to not have to go through the stretching process as well.
And how big are your works? We're losing some of the vibrant colors, I think, on the translation with television, but how big are your works?
The majority of the works that you'll see this evening are what's considered a full sheet of watercolor paper. It's 22 by 30 inches.
Okay, well, thank you, James. You really are an incredible artist. Keep up the good work.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you very much.
So it's much appreciated.
There you go. There you go. Well, you have a lot of admirers. I've noticed that. That your work is gaining some attention.
That means a lot.
Yep. So it's on the upswing, I think. And I think, and folks, now is the time to buy this gentleman's art. I'm serious. He has what's happening is he's only getting better and more expensive. So think about getting it now because it's going to be worth some money in the next few years. But I want to hit the next.
There we go. All right, and here is another image. This was a hospital out in Missouri. I had mentioned before that there's a juried exhibition in which I frequently participate, Watercolor USA, and my exploration of the country and pursuit of this career in art brought me out there for an exhibition. But I figured, well, why not while I'm out here take some time to explore the locations, and St. Louis was a fantastic wealth of abandonments, and you know, if you're looking for entropy, St. Louis is not a bad place to find it.
Yeah, I've heard the same thing.
This image here is a little bit, you know, hits closer to home. While I don't believe it's Berks County, I think we're a little bit, this is a little bit further southeast. This image here, which is actually, it's up in New York right now, so one of a few shows that I'm currently loaning work out to. This is Pennhurst, of kind of local fame, a psychiatric hospital among a number peppered up and down the East Coast of the Kirkbride buildings. Now in disrepair after the kind of shut down of a lot of them due to some legislation in the 70s and 80s. It's really an interesting story, well worth researching, not only Pennhurst specifically, but all of these other, you know, Kirkbride hospitals. And during its kind of repose and its the entropic process that it's undergoing, it's great to see the paint peeling from the walls, the plaster, how the elements really work at a structure like this. I find it fascinating.
Well, that all adds to the content of the work, too, because you see all of the minutia of what happens to a place like this. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of paintings just get grayed out, get washed out in the process, but you spend a lot of time, you know, looking. Mm-hmm. And seeing what is actually there. I mean, there's like, you can actually see the pieces of broken glass on the floor, strings, wires, peeling paint, cracks in the wall, everything is right there. The tiles, and looking in the back of it, you can actually see the mortar on the brick walls.
Yeah.
I mean, so that's some pretty good observation there.
It's funny, you know, what I've learned about the construction of these buildings in, you know, throughout different eras as I watch them decompose, and as different layers of the infrastructure of these buildings are revealed to me through the damage that's done to them. It's a cool experience. There's no doubt about it.
Well, it's also probably a very interesting excursion for you to go and find these places, because you never know what you're going to see when you go in there.
Or who I'm going to see.
Or who you're going to see.
Yeah.
Some guy in a face mask with a...
It's, you know? nothing quite so horrific as anything in the movies, although I'd be remiss to not give attention to those who do live in some of these mm-hmm. places in our metropolitan mm-hmm. areas, not so much with the rural industrial spaces, mm-hmm. but a lot of these locations are homes to those who don't otherwise, you know, have homes. And there is something to be said, you know, for that side of my experience in these buildings. You know, to always be respectful of those who live there is something that's hugely important to me.
Yeah, because it's probably just as much of an emotional issue for them.
Oh, sure.
To see somebody going, you know, to be living next to something like that.
Right.
You know, you have a broken down building that's been there for decades, and, you know, well, they want to get rid of it too. They want to either get rid of it or fix it up or do something to make their neighborhood look a little bit more human.
Right.
You know, I can understand that. But let me ask you this question.
Sure.
You had mentioned you're a member of a watercolor club. What is the, what was that again?
Yeah, the various watercolor societies, and these exist on international levels, on national levels, regional levels. Mm-hmm. Some of the most prominent watercolor exhibitions are produced by local groups, the Philadelphia Watercolor Society, the Pennsylvania Watercolor Society, AWS and NWS, the American National Watercolor Societies, are two of the more prestigious shows, you know, to be accepted to as a watercolorist. And that mentioned that piece in Pennhurst, mm-hmm. Which we were just looking at, that's up in New York for AWS right now. So I've had some really fantastic opportunities to exhibit my work through those organizations, and mm-hmm. I would be it wouldn't be fair to them to not mention what that's done for my career as mm-hmm. as a painter.
So which organizations are you a member of?
Well, with the acceptance of this recent work to AWS, this will be my second acceptance to that
American Watercolor Society.
Yep, to the American Watercolor Society. With the acceptance of this work, which is the second in 2 years, I'm now eligible for signature membership with them. And after my a couple exhibitions with the Springfield Art Museum mm-hmm. that I mentioned before, Watercolor Honor Society is another group. And they do some fantastic work in terms of curating, collecting, and facilitating watercolor work on a grander scale. It's mm-hmm. really, you know, great thing to be a part of.
Do you ever think of working larger? I mean, you have a standard size right now. Do you feel that you ever want to go like?
Yeah, it's there are some logistical hoops to jump through when it comes to stuff like that. The paper that I mentioned earlier, that hot press, unfortunately, A, very expensive. B, they also don't make it any larger than 22 by 30. The hot press specifically. So I'm looking at stacking up a couple of the same size that I work next to one another.
Cool. Well, okay, we're gonna take a short break here and be back in about 30 seconds with James Maria. This is New Arts Alive. Thank you.
You're watching New Arts Alive on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and an arts calendar, go to www.bctv.org.
Arts programming on BCTV is supported by the Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts.
And we're back. Hi, that was quick, wasn't it? Okay, we are with New Arts Alive with James Maria, and we are broadcasting from Reading, Pennsylvania, from Burke's Community Television Studios. I'm Ron Schira. So let's move ahead.
All right, sounds good. Well, let's get right to the images, I guess.
Okay, we have some more images. This is always the best thing to show what you do, I think.
Yeah, I mean, who needs to look at me? I would rather look at my work than myself anyway.
Or me too, you know.
So here is, this piece was kind of a watermark in my career a little bit, as young as my career is. This piece was accepted to that show in Missouri and was one of the first real accomplishments in my career. Not only because of the, you know, sort of critical response that it garnered, but also because it was the first painting that I did of a location that is very near and dear to my heart, and also an industry that resonates with me on a pretty deep level, and also has a lot to say about the content of my work, and that is the coal industry here in Pennsylvania. this particular location depicted in this painting is the Huber Breaker in Ashley, Pennsylvania, just south of Wilkes-Barre. Nanticoke is the nearest city that you might know if you're from down in Berks County. And something about the way all of the pipes, the rusting sort of textures mixed with the brick and also juxtaposed with the cement and how all of it sort of came together really, really interested me. After discovering this location, I became kind of hungry to see more coal breakers as I realized that they're a very rich part of Pennsylvania's history. And if we go to our next image here, we'll see the second location that I discovered. This is St. Nicholas Coal Breaker, just outside of Mahanoy City, up in the central PA coal regions. Something about these coal breakers that's worth noting is that in their prime and before their shutdown in the 70s, they were two of the most productive and two of the largest coal breakers in the world, feeding some of the Pennsylvania steel industry as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, these are really, really important to Pennsylvania's history. Also worth noting about both of these, and if we go to the next one, we can see a little bit of the first one that I mentioned, the Huber Breaker. Both of these locations have just been kind of slated for teardown and for repurposing. Ashley, the Huber Breaker, which is depicted here, is I think as of January 14th, its demolition had started, and there's not much left of it. It is slowly making its way to just a blip on the horizon at this point, which is wild. This is kind of the last. I'm not sure if anyone else has painted it, but for me, I feel pride in that I've taken part in the last documentation of its sort of final years and its war with nature.
Well, the coal regions has been a major supplier, of fuel for electrical supply as well. Because at one time they used a lot of coal to make electricity. And I also notice here, well, being that this is a triptych, you have some chemical some equations. It looks like some fusion equation or something.
Well, here I've. I guess first I'll address the triptych format.
Yeah.
Some of the deeper layers of my work, in addition to thinking about, you know, sort of the surface things that are called to mind, the more superficial, the shifts in economy and in industry, not that those aren't worth discussing, but a lot of my work, this idea of entropy and this idea of human order being kind of taken over or reordered or by nature, there's also something a little bit more spiritual about that, and being from a Roman Catholic background and being a practicing Roman Catholic today, the iconography, the visual language of the Catholic Church is something that has always, you know, sort of inspired me.
Mm-hmm.
And to create an altarpiece, or that is...
a predella.
Right, or, you know, a backdrop mm-hmm. for... spiritual contemplation is something that I wanted to do. And what's not especially easy to tell from this reproduction is that the linear elements on the left, including the chemical sort of schematic there, those are done in gold leaf, also borrowed from the sort of visual traditions and techniques and practices of, you know, the Christian art. The idea of repurposing is something that's, you know, pretty inextricably intertwined with the idea of fossil fuel, that this was once organic material, likely once something that was, you know, living and walking around or being eaten by something that was living and walking around, and now it serves a completely different purpose after time has acted upon it. And those are the sorts of questions that we might ask, you know, about this space, is that this was once metaphorically, this living, breathing site, and now, you know, now it is no longer. And what purpose does this space serve now? Is it a home for wildlife? Is it a home for human life on occasion? And well, now that it's being repurposed, more literally as scrap, you know, what life might these materials, what way might they live on now?
So we might be melting them down or using them in, well, the steel industry, I mean.
Right, sure. Yeah, you know, yeah. Be it bridges, new buildings, things like that. There's mm-hmm. you know, endless possibilities. Although I have to admit that I would have preferred to see the structure live on, as it is a really important historical site. There's been a lot of folks interested in preserving it, mm-hmm. you know, for its historical significance.
So you believe that a factory has just the same sort of historical significance than, say, a large mansion out in the historic district?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, it has the same. It has the same importance. Mm-hmm. It could be used for a number of different things. I mean, we have a few buildings in the city,
right,
which can be adapted for other sources.
Sure. Right? Yeah. I mean, post-industrial spaces have long been employed by, especially, you know, the artist community. Mm-hmm. Look at the goggle works itself. Once, you know, it was a former factory, now being used to show artwork. The banana factory in Bethlehem, you know, even the steel stacks themselves now mm-hmm. serving as kind of the backdrop for their arts endeavors. You know, this is the sort of thing mm-hmm. that could be salvageable, and new life and new positivity could be, you know, breathed into mm-hmm. these locations.
See, and this is something that our cities and our city governments don't recognize. I feel that they
often,
don't.
You
know, some do, some don't. But you know, the Goggle Works is proof of it. That, you know, we had investors come in. You know, people
sure.
like the boss, like Mr. Boscov and mm-hmm. Marlon Miller, and they have totally revamped that old building to become this creative space, which is still active right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, thank goodness for it, because it really has put Reading on a map.
Absolutely.
So, but it should be looked at more carefully, that artists have been able to change things around, but they need support from
right.
the government. I mean, an artist is traditionally a very poor person, you know. They
yep.
usually go into the worst neighborhoods, fix them up, and then get pushed out by some...
yeah, Soho, yeah, and then yep. Chelsea. And
then Soho, and then Chelsea, and
right.
now we're going over to Bushwick.
Right.
We're not that big. We can fit all of Reading in Brooklyn.
Indeed. Now, the two works, it's worth mentioning, the two works that we just looked at, the two triptychs, were part of a show that I recently just exhibited in Lancaster.
Mm-hmm.
The next couple images will reflect that as well. This is a smaller... what I considered a vignette, or almost a portrait, rather than being something so large as the triptychs that mm-hmm. Gave you a larger sense of the setting that really articulated the space. I wanted to give some more intimate looks into yeah. these spaces, and so I did a number of these smaller paintings. This is a quarter of the size, you know, that which I normally work. And it gave me an opportunity, a little bit of opportunity to rest, which was, you know, kind of nice. But just to calm my mind for a little bit and to explore some smaller works. This work sold.
Well, it is very intimate. It's almost like these two objects, the broom and the desk lamp, are having a conversation.
Right.
And it seems like they're both bathed in the light, almost as if there's a confrontation going on. There's some sort of psychology happening here. The door is open, the light's coming in on them both, they're at a distance from each other. There is a subtle psychology to this.
Yeah, you've unpacked and observed that really nicely. And the broom there kind of represents our predilection to order things and to sort of sweep up nature. We like to remove the outside world from the spaces that we've created. But what the other sort of sense, there's an implicit relationship here between the lighting fixture, this, you know, industrial lamp, and the natural light, that even after this industrial lamp has stopped serving its purpose, that the natural light in the end won out. Mm-hmm. I think we might have more of these vignettes.
Okay. Well, one question, though.
Oh, sure.
Is this now technically to be what they call a purist, in quotes, you're supposed to leave the white of the paper.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you do, or is that a...
Yeah, I do not use gouache or anything like that. I've been, for some time, a purist to the extent that up until very recently, I didn't even use any sort of masking fluid. All the white of the paper was maintained just by technique. It's me, brushes, pigment, and water.
And discipline.
A little bit of that, too.
A little bit of patience, too. Yeah, more patience than I have.
Here's another smaller vignette, one of the portraits that I did of St. Nicholas Coalbreaker. This was in one of the office rooms as well.
Very nice.
Thank you. The bottles and things that were left there, I was inspired by the way that a lot of the former occupants, the workers, and whoever was in charge, you know, a lot of things just seemed to have been left there. That once it was shut down, you know, life seemed to cease. I mean, it's also worth noting that in my few years of exploring this location or going back there to visit, the rapid deterioration of some of these spaces due to the human presence in them. And that's something that I deal with pretty frequently. Unfortunately, it's a reality of abandoned spaces, especially in metropolitan areas, that some of the decay, the urban decay, or the entropy that I document needs to be sorted through. You know, the difference between human destruction of a space by vandals and things versus what occurs naturally. And that's the natural, you know, processes are what I'm interested in. As you can see from all of these recent works, I've completely eliminated any graffiti or anything like that. I try to remove that element. I think that it doesn't necessarily speak to what I'm, you know, what I'm going after.
I do see that well, in the previous, one of the previous ones too, when we had come back from the break, you also had a window in that one as well, and you can see outside to the trees. But you also have in this one, you have some broken glass. It's so that it's distorting the image of the nature outside,
right?
Which I find interesting as well.
It's partially obscured. I mean, this idea that nature is sort of teeming and begging for an opportunity, for an entrance, is as much an interesting, you know, visual kind of device as it is something a little bit more, you know, content-driven. I like this idea that that nature desires to reclaim these spaces, and that as it's given smaller entrances here and there, even on a much smaller level, this idea of mold or moss or, you know, even the smallest forms of life, as the space grows, you know, it gives an opportunity to be reclaimed.
And you use the word entropy a few times here. Now, technically, entropy just means decay.
Yeah, the tending of order towards disorder. But what I find interesting about that that definition is that there's this implication that there's some sort of standard for what is order. You know, what is it that is, or whose order is that relying on, you know? Is it the order that we impose on an architectural level? You know, I think that a few winters are enough to, or even just a few months is enough to see that potholes are a fantastic example of entropy.
Just go over the Penn Street Bridge.
Right. Yeah. But, you know, on an architectural level, but also on a molecular level, you know, this idea that we create and we make these materials like steel, things like that, and they aren't inherently entirely stable. You know, they rust, they oxidize, they corrode, and there's a certain order that is being reached by those processes. You know, that maybe the natural order, that maybe this building being completely crumbled into nothing is the order, and it's all a matter of sort of recontextualizing.
Or maybe like the order was arrested by humanity,
right?
And now since the human element is out of it, it's becoming what it would be nature-wise.
Sure. Looks like we have a home viewer.
A home viewer. Wow. Okay. Very good. You are on. Go ahead.
Hi. How are you? I have a follow-up question. I was the first guy who called.
Before. Oh, all right.
I just find your work absolutely fascinating. I do have a question for you, James.
Sure.
Since your works that we're seeing tonight are industrial sites and schools and like a still life that is inside the office of one of the breakers and industrial sites, do you work off a photograph?
Yeah. All of the photos from which I derive this information are taken by myself. But that's important to me that I take the photos myself, or that I be in the space when I take that photo to let that emotional experience inform me when I later go to paint.
And then do you interpret what you have photographed, like the lighting on that last still life with the bottle and so on? Are you taking it verbatim off your photograph, or are you just using the photograph as a guide, and then in your creative mind come up with how you want the light to be?
I think it's a little bit closer to what you described at the end there. If I were just taking the photograph and reproducing it verbatim, it wouldn't say much for why I'm a painter at all. At that point, I might as well go, photograph it and have a photo show. And there's nothing wrong with that. I think photography and this subject matter, it's a very common sort of combination of this subject and that discipline. But what I do is I'll use the photo as kind of the framework. And then that emotional experience that I mentioned earlier, that's what informs my work, and that's what the expressive sort of side of things that creeps in and makes the work that much more interesting.
Well, thank you, James.
Absolutely. You're very welcome.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for calling.
So we have... that's definitely important. If mm-hmm. it wasn't for what I was trying to convey emotionally, if it wasn't for my experience in those spaces, it would just be simply a matter of a documentation.
Right.
It would be documentary at nature and not as much about an artistic statement.
Very good point. Thank you. It's not so much like you're just trying to copy.
Right.
Right. You also want to make an interpretation.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's funny. Kandinsky actually, talked about that in some of his writing. Mm-hmm. Just this idea that there's something that's conveyed by the artist, something a little bit more metaphysical that's worked into a physical work of art, and it's the job then of the artist once it gets into the piece. Mm-hmm. to make its way to the viewer, and mm-hmm. and that established line of communication is something that I think all artists should really strive for.
Yeah.
And not that documentation is incapable of that process, or that a photo is devoid of that. I don't think that would be fair at all to that medium, a medium which is also close to my heart, and a process, a discipline that I appreciate and on which I rely pretty heavily for my watercolors. But I find that I am most emotionally and spiritually sort of articulate through watercolor itself. And mm-hmm. I think part of that is because it acts the way it wants to sometimes. Mm-hmm. This idea that I'm not in complete control. And if that's what my work is essentially about, that's also a close tie between the content of my work and the material. And I think that that's something that artists should consider as well.
Well, and then again, too, somebody that we both know well mm-hmm. has said numerous times that the questions are more important.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that you should have an artwork that generates a question, not necessarily an artwork that supplies an answer.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep.
So I think we have a few more here?
Yeah, we do.
Well, we have about 10 minutes left. That's
yeah.
good. Okay. So let's go to the next one here. We showed a tiny bit of this, but mm-hmm. This one here is another. It's another still life.
Yep, another smaller work from the same location.
In a way, this is also kind of staying with the tradition mm-hmm. of still life and you know, and academic art.
Yeah.
But it uses such a different subject matter that it really throws it into a realm all its own.
Yes. The story behind these you know, smaller paintings, I have to admit, is kind of interesting, and I was admittedly reluctant to pursue the still life format. But my gallery director down in Lancaster recommended it to me. She recommended the smaller size and this format as being something that she thought that her market would respond to. And while I was initially not super pleased with the suggestion, admittedly, it ended up being really rewarding because it got me working out of, you know, exclusively these architectural spaces and allowed me to focus a little bit more. And like I said, it was something of a respite for me, mm-hmm. and allowed me to explore something new.
Well, sometimes it's a good thing to try something different to get out of your métier to to exercise your capabilities.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It doesn't hurt you to step out of your modus, you know, mm-hmm. once in a while.
Yeah. So we got one. What, we have one more?
Oh, we have a few more yet.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. All right.
This is an example of one of the pieces that was also in that Lancaster show. Although this format also differs, not necessarily in the process of the painting itself, but the presentation. Again, borrowing from some of the iconography, the visual language of Catholic art, I've employed a very ornate frame. And I also admit, I have a love for antiquing. So Adamstown and some of the other local antique markets are a huge part of my work, and I kind of like objects with history and using them to present my work.
Mm-hmm.
But what's especially noteworthy is the smaller frame at the bottom, which houses a small piece of anthracite from that coal breaker.
I was going to ask you what that was.
It's kind of my contemporary stand-in for a reliquary, borrowed from that kind of visual tradition. And the mm-hmm. next image as well. Now this is Saint Nicholas. This is the Huber breaker, a reliquary and a painting that I did for that location as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now this location is the focus of a show that I have upcoming in Scranton, and I've painted three other large paintings for this show, which I've included in this slideshow. I'm looking forward to showing them as well. Before we do that, really quickly, as I mentioned, I am an oil painter, and I do work with gold leaf in this icon format as well. So I have two of those here as well.
So this is an oil paint.
This is an oil painting. Yeah,
oh, but what size is this?
9x12, maybe.
Wow, that's pretty intense for 9x12.
Yeah, I like to work intimately for anything that functions almost like an icon. I did take an icon writing exercise with a master icon painter writer up in Scranton, and that was a really cool, contemplative, prayerful sort of mm-hmm. process. Very, very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And here another oil painting as well, with the gold leaf borrowed from those sort of precedents established in Christian art.
Yeah.
Here's another of the Huber breaker.
Mm-hmm.
And this work is actually, it was part of AWS last year and was sold during its traveling show. In my decision to paint this, I took a couple different photo resources mm-hmm. from this location at this particular excursion. In addition to this one, which I titled Meditation on Promise and Providence, this idea of thinking about what we've been given and what may be given to us yet. The next work is just the other view, and the view from where I had been, you know, standing before and where I was looking. I've just mirrored it and reversed it, and this is my reflection on Promise and Providence, my reflection on my experiences there and on that location as its, you know, sort of lifespan comes to a close.
Mm-hmm. Your lighting is literally perfect.
Thank you. Yeah. From the power station, mm-hmm, at the that same location.
Now this is this really shows your skill here, because of the reflective light on the window panes and the change of space from indoor to outdoor, the fence posts, the gate there. I mean, and I'm sure that people are very curious to find out about how long it would take you to do something like this.
Some of the earlier works that we saw were about 40 to 50 hours, and we're now up to around 60 to 65 hours, mm-hmm, per painting, including the drawing itself. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, people, buy this work. Buy this work.
I have one more image, and this last image, I think, has probably taken me the most time. I think this was around 65, maybe close to 70 hours. So this has been my most labor-intensive piece to date.
Wow, wow. And it's obvious. It really shows. It really shows. So we're down to 1 minute left. So we're gonna have to close up here. I want to thank you.
No, thank you. The opportunity was a pleasure.
Yeah,
I appreciate
mine as well. You know, it's always good to get, you know, somebody different. You know,
yeah.
Somebody, you know, that's got some, you know, skill and stuff. You know, not that the other guests that I've had in here didn't have any.
Right.
But you know, of course, you know. But anyway, you're a very good speaker.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you for joining us tonight on New Arts Alive with James Maria, painter, and me, Ron Schira. Thank you very much for joining us, and have a wonderful night.
Have a good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by